morning, Mountain View Church. It is certainly odd to be here at the sanctuary without you guys, because like we say often, the church, it's not a building, it's a people. So we look forward to the time when we can get back together and gather as a church family here. But until we do, some announcements. Youth group, Grief Share, and Women Encouraging Women, those groups won't be meeting this week. Also, because we won't be getting together physically for the next few weeks, it's really a good opportunity to become familiar with our online giving platform. Pretty simple, just go to mvcglenwood.org, our website, and click the Giving tab, and then just follow the steps through to make your weekly offering. We'll also send around an email with those steps, as well as a tutorial video, just to make everything super clear. A lot of you already know this, but this past week, Rick McClellan, one of our longtime church members and family members, passed away. And in a lot of ways, it was a mercy. Rick had been struggling with his health for a while, and he was surrounded by his family when he went home, his family around him, and his Savior in front of him. So we're thankful. This week, we'll be holding a celebration of Rick's life, a funeral service here at the church. Unfortunately, because of the coronavirus ban, we won't be able to have a full service, but just a family service, and then a gravesite service at Rosebud Cemetery at 2:30 p.m. We'll also tape the service, so you'll be able to see that online if you can't attend. Let's take some time now to pray for our message and also for the McClellan family. Dear Heavenly Father God, we thank you that you are a God of resurrection with our current worries and issues, but also with our long-term hope of resurrection, that which Rick and we will too experience and celebrate, because you have beaten death and you are the Lord of life. And so we thank you for that. Encourage us. I pray for the McClellan family especially. Let them feel your love and your provision for them and your presence right in their midst. And grow us. Grow us through everything we go through, we ask. I pray for this message as we look into the Bible. God, feed us with what we need for this day. Give us daily bread. In Jesus' name, amen. We're currently in a series called Finding Jesus, a study in Luke. And this morning, we think about Luke 3. It has one of those monster-long genealogies of Jesus. You know what I'm talking about? One of those super long lists of difficult names to pronounce that will give you the sweats if it's your turn to read out loud at small group Bible study. A genealogy might be something that seems weird to read considering the coronavirus scare, but it may be perfect to give us a wider sense of God's provision historically. This morning, I was on the Facebook page for the Roaring Fork Marketplace, and I saw a posting there by a lady, let's call her Sue. And here's what she wrote. I really need a couple of rolls of toilet paper and am willing to pay fair market value for them. I messaged her back and said, Sue, I have a couple of spare rolls of toilet paper and am willing to give them to you at a fair price, free. People need to take care of people, so let me know if you need those. Fortunately, a few months ago, Michelle and I were at Costco, and for some reason, we stocked up on a ridiculous amount of white gold currency, so we're rich. And if you need a couple extra rolls, you let us know. We'll hook you up. It may seem strange to have a mass run on something like toilet paper, but what might be undergirding it is a hysteria that's pushed forward by a narrow focus. Fortunately, Christians are given and safeguarded from narrow terror by being able to study the biblical history of God's stubborn provision for his people, even in some of the darkest times. So for the next few minutes, we're going to study a genealogy of Jesus and note all the different ways that God has provided for his people throughout hundreds of years of the salvation narrative. There are two genealogies in the New Testament. One is in Luke 3, one is in Matthew 1. For this morning, we're going to study Matthew 1 because the genealogy through Jesus' line, through Mary, gives us a little bit more detail. So let's go to the Bible and we'll study it now. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. Note that of the 12 sons of Jacob, Judah alone is mentioned, as his descendants proved to be the royal line of the kings of Israel, from whom the Messiah would come. Verse 3 continues, and Judah the father of Perez,
and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Ram, and Ram the father of Abinadab. Abinadab was a chief warrior mentioned in Numbers chapter 1 in association with the pivotal desert wandering of the Hebrew people during the time of Moses. And Abinadab the father of Nishon, and Nishon the father of Salmon, and Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. It's interesting that two of the women mentioned in the genealogy of Christ are Rahab and Ruth. Rahab was a Canaanite prostitute that helped protect the Hebrew spies before their invasion of Jericho. And Ruth was also an outsider. She was raised as a worshiper of human sacrifice made to the god Chemosh, the god of the people of Moab. Remarkably, these two women, with their sketchy pasts, nonetheless became faithful followers of the God of the Bible, and important figures in the line of Jesus. Their lives demonstrate the fulfillment of the promise that God made to Abraham, that through God's working, Israel would shine a light to the nations. Verse 6 continues, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. The genealogy doesn't cover anything up, and it seems to almost go out of its way to remind the reader that Solomon was the offspring of David and Bathsheba, Bathsheba the wife of Uriah. Uriah was the man that David had killed so that he might hide his sin of adultery with Bathsheba. And for all his passionate faithfulness to God, even King David was deeply flawed and in need of continual forgiveness and grace. The genealogy continues, and in the 8th century BC, during the reign of Rehoboam, the kingdom of Israel was split into a northern and southern kingdom. The following list of the southern kings reflects a mixed bag of characters, some faithful to the God of their fathers, and some incredibly wicked, doing everything they could to turn the people against the God of the Bible. Verse 7 reads, and Solomon the father of Rehoboam, and Rehoboam the father of Abijah, and Abijah the father of Asaph, and Asaph the father of Jehoshaphat, and Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, and Joram the father of Uzziah, and Uzziah the father of Jotham, and Jotham the father of Ahaz, and Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, and Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, and Manasseh the father of Amos, and Amos the father of Josiah, and Josiah the father of Jeconiah, and his brothers, at the time of the deportation to Babylon. In the 6th century BC, the rebellion of the southern kingdom against God reached such a towering height that in corrective punishment, God allowed King Nebuchadnezzar, ruler of the powerhouse neighboring kingdom of Babylon, to overcome the Jewish people and take into exile notable Old Testament figures such as Daniel and Esther. And even during the 70 years of captivity in Babylon, God continued to pursue his greater plan of salvation, bringing the Jewish people back to their homeland. Verse 12, and after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, and Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel the father of Abed, and Abed the father of Elikayam, Elikayam the father of Azor, Azor the father of Zadok, Zadok the father of Achim, Achim the father of Eliad, Eliad the father of Elizur, Elizur the father of Mathan, Mathan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Christ. Jesus, from the name Yeshua, meaning he saves, and Christ, a title designating the chosen one of God. Though there were not only a few periods of darkness and disaster in the narrative and the genealogy, the long-standing promise of God's salvation is fulfilled in the life of Christ.
A good visual that comes to my mind when thinking about the salvation narrative recorded in the Bible is a long rope. The Messiah didn't just pop up out of nowhere. We see continuity between Abraham and Jesus. And there are times where it feels like the covenant between God and his people becomes so frayed and worn that it's hanging by just a thread. But it never breaks, because God is the ultimate promise keeper. I hope that by walking through the genealogy of Jesus this morning, you've been encouraged that God does and did and is able to powerfully work through flawed people and non-ideal situations to continue his mission of redeeming a broken world through the loving rescue of his son. If you happen to be watching this sermon with other people, a great application question to talk through after you log off is this. As a group of people trusting in Christ, how can we show, share, and serve people this week with the hope of the gospel? As I often say, the gospel is really the gospel when it's action. So what are creative ways that God is putting on your heart and mind to action the gospel this week? Because the opening is ripe. Also, some recommended reading. A good recommendation would be to read through the first 6 chapters of the book of Daniel, a chapter each day, and pray through it. The book of Daniel really is a historical primer that shows us how we can be faithful and flourish in even a challenging environment like Daniel's. Also, next week, we will be recording a full service, so both the worship band and music, as well as the message. So stay tuned for that. All of our videos will be posted on our Facebook page, as well as our website. Before we sign off, we'll close with our regular benediction, because although we're not in the same room together, we are on the same mission together. So I'll read our benediction and go ahead and respond where you would. So our identity and mission. Remember, we are the church, so wherever you go, Christ goes. If somebody asks you this week what your church is like, tell them, I am what my church is like. Remember, we are the church, and we may be the only contact someone has with Jesus this week. So though they may not yet come to our church, we can bring the church to them. Amen. Let's go out and do that. And I'll see you next week, same time, same place. Blessed be your